The government's decision to criminalise coming home for Australian citizens is just revolting.
Scott Morrison often boasts that he turned back the boats, and now he's turning back the Aussies.
I don't think it matters if it was India, if it was Sri Lanka, if it was Madagascar. We should help Australians that are in distress. It's what we do normally. This seems to be an exception.
Amid mounting criticism of its extraordinary new sanctions, some from within the party room, the federal government's stuck to its guns.
I understand the measures have strong sanctions with them, but we've had the Biosecurity Act in place now for over a year, and no one's gone to jail. There's no politics or ideology in a pandemic, and I'm constantly taken aback by those who seek to inject it into it.
Our advice is based on the Chief Medical Officer of Australia.
Entirely founded in the advice of the Chief Medical Officer.
Today, the Chief Medical Officer offering this clarification.
What I was asked for was public health advice. I didn't advise anything in relation to fines or any of those other matters. That is the law.
Kelly's advisory letter also warned that the ban could put Australian citizens in India at risk of serious illness without access to healthcare and, in worst-case scenario, deaths. He recommended mitigating those risks by making restrictions temporary and by ensuring there are categories of exemption. But while the government's taken both recommendations on board...
This is a temporary pause. At the moment it sunsets on the 15th of May.
Exemptions only apply to diplomats, government officials, aid workers and air crew. The 9,000-plus ordinary citizens stuck in India's COVID nightmare forced to fend for themselves.
We saw a 1,500% increase in cases from India in 2 months, and that led to an agonising decision.
I can only imagine the agony of families who are separated between Australia and India, with the Australian government preventing them from returning.
I would just implore all those Australians and Australian residents as well, with family and friends in India who have Indian heritage, I want to thank them for their patience and their understanding.
To unpack the politics of this, Amy Rimikas joins us from Canberra. Amy, is the government on solid ground here when it says that it is just acting on expert advice?
Well, the government says that it has medical advice, which the medical experts have confirmed, that says that basically our quarantine system would not cope as it is with the influx of Indian arrivals from India. But this time it's different because they've not only just banned flights, they've also banned people, which is another step we haven't seen the government undertake during this pandemic.
You do just have to wonder, though, Amy, whether the federal government's seen how popular those border closures have been in the other states. Look at those elections in Queensland and WA and Tassie. But the opposition to this has been across the board. You've got Andrew Bolt calling it racist, Matt Canavan, a coalition frontbencher, criticising it, and the Labor Party also having a crack. So have they miscalculated this completely, do you think?
Well, I would hope that no public health decisions are ever made on popularity like this, because that would leave the country in a very, very poor state. But it is true that we have not seen this sort of action taken for any other nation that has seen an influx of COVID cases. It was only a few months ago in December that about 40% of the cases in New South Wales were coming from people who were arriving from the United States.
We didn't have health advice, though, recommending something like this in the case of those other outbreaks in other countries like the US or in the UK. So is there something different about this particular case?
What it comes down to is that our quarantine system is not up to handling this many cases. That's the be-all and end-all of all of this. We do not have the federal quarantine facilities that would be able to handle this. They're very worried about it becoming airborne. Hotel quarantine was not meant to be in place for this long. It was not set up for any sort of airborne sort of disease, and that's what they're worried about. So this is going to be a problem that's going to take quite some time to fix.
Indeed. Indeed, the federal government wants to fix the quarantine arrangements, which have suggested they don't particularly have an appetite for at the moment. But anyway, Amy, thank you very much for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, there is a sunset clause on this particular change to the regulation. So when you get to a date in May, they may rethink the idea.
But why would they? Because what's going to change in 2 weeks?
Nothing is going to change at all.
Surely it's only getting worse.
They've got to come up with a better solution. I spoke to a young guy this morning whose brother died in India at the weekend. He's got an Australian passport. He's an Australian citizen.
Waiting to come home?
Yes. I never thought I'd live in a country where my own passport doesn't get me back to my own country. Mm. Amy made a good point there that in the past we've stopped flights, but we haven't stopped people. We're now saying to Australian citizens who happen to be in India for whatever reason, you can't come to Australia. I think that's
criminal.
So what
do we do about it, given we don't have the appropriate...
Get a naval ship out of Garden Island, send it to India, get all the Australians who want to leave on board, put them into medical care on board that naval ship, take 2 weeks to get back.
Well, they'd need to go... Like, you need to use things like Christmas Island or something like that.
Sure.
It's probably the way to do it.
It's empty.
But what I genuinely don't... I think I can understand why the federal government's doing most of this, but what I can't understand is why they're refusing to engage on the quarantine question. So if you're
expanding it and finding better quarantine.
They don't want to run it.
So you're basically admitting now, like at the same time as you're saying we have the best quarantine in the world, you're admitting it's not up to the task.
Correct.
If that's the case, like I think people could cop this very easily if you said we can't do this now, so we're going to put a ban on it.
I'll tell you what.
But here's what we are doing that we can deal with this down the track.
Look at what happened to Daniel Andrews when the quarantine system failed in Victoria. He copped all the criticism. Federal government doesn't want to run it because they don't want to be blamed when it doesn't work.
But the Victorian proposal from last week didn't even have them, the feds, running it. It had Victoria running it.
Yeah.
So why do you think they'll use Christmas Island?
I don't know why they won't use Christmas Island. I think that the word Christmas Island probably politically is dangerous for them to actually go back into that
space. They used it before. They used it at the very start of the pandemic. Remember, they were taking people out of China. And I remember because...
We spoke to people on Christmas Island.
I remember hearing that and going, bloody hell, you can't do that. Turns out you can, and I don't know why you can't now. I don't know. I don't understand. From expert opinions to in-depth analysis and reporting, the Project YouTube brings you the biggest stories from Australia and around the globe. Hit the subscribe button now for news delivered straight to your feed.